Fantastic. Isn't it great to be here? Yeah, it really is great to be here. That is an understatement. That's exactly right. It is an understatement. What a privilege to be in the house of the Lord, to worship, to rejoice, to dedicate babies to the Lord, to say, Lord, have your way in their lives. It's a privilege. We take no day for granted. Now we're turning our attention to the Word of God. And this is the time we're really just asking God to open our eyes to see what He would show us, open our ears to hear what He would say to us, as Pastor Eric prayed. And so this Sunday, we're kicking off a four-part series out of the book of Ephesians. And we're calling that series Chosen. And we're very specific, very deliberate about doing that, because if you know something about the book of Ephesians, you know that this is Paul's letter to a church that he really rejoiced in. Rejoiced in what God was doing in their lives, had done to make them a church, and he wanted them to keep on keeping on in the way that they had been shaped and brought about, brought together as a community by the work of Jesus Christ. If you know something about the other letters that Paul wrote, other churches didn't get off so well. Oftentimes, he's taken them to the woodshed, like the church at Corinth, because they had divisions, and they were dividing over people and personalities and doctrine. They were fairly self-centered. They would just kind of have communion whenever they wanted to do it, each individual. And so he had to kind of correct them. Another church he had a real concern with was the church in Galatia, because they had let heresies start to creep in and pollute the gospel that he'd been given, to the point where he said, what you guys are listening to is no gospel at all. And so he has to correct the church in Galatia. He has to upbraid, to some extent, the church in Corinth. Now, he does this as a loving father, and he always provides encouragement and hope, but he's doing this to those churches. In Ephesus, he's really presenting us a blueprint, if you will, of what it means to be in Christ and what it means to be the church. And the best way to describe what he's talking about is that we have been chosen by God to be in him and to be this community of believers. And through the six chapters that comprise the book of Ephesians, he starts to unpack bit by bit what that means. And so we're going to look at that over the course of the next 4 weeks. And this will be brought to you by the pastoral team. And we're looking forward just to share what God has put on our heart. So if you got your Bible, would you turn with me, please, to Ephesians 1, I'm going to read verses 3 to 14. By the way, for the guys in the sound booth, I'm getting some feedback somewhere. I feel like I've got multiple personalities or something. But anyway, thank you. That's getting better. So we're going to read verses 3 to 14, and as you hear this, you're going to hear a fair amount of theological richness, of themes that are ones that, if you've done any bit of study about the Christian faith or about doctrine, you're going to hear some phrases that are going to sound really familiar, and it's going to feel pretty weighty. This is not a snack. This is not light refreshment. This is a full-on meal in this passage. So just listen to what God would say to you. Still getting a little feedback before I start. Okay, but I'm not going to worry about that. We're going to read chapter 1 of Ephesians, verses 3 to 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Amen. Wow, is that a lot? I mean, did that sort of feel like there's a lot of theology going on here? There's a lot of amazing stuff that's being described. And why is that? Because essentially, this is a doxology. This is a hymn to God about all the marvelous things that he has done. Now, Paul, being a Pharisee and being very familiar with Jewish forms of praise, he actually fits this into a form of praise that would have been familiar to the original hearers if you were Jewish. So he's saying, I just want to give this huge, big praise to God, a massive shout out of what God has done for us. And he's doing that in almost this breathless tone. In the way that Paul wrote it, in the original Greek, this is one sentence. I don't know how many sentences we actually read and how many phrases, but there were a lot. But the way Paul wrote it was just one big sentence to show us what it means, all the things that Christ has done for us. And we're going to start to unpack that so that we would realize that, as Paul said to the Ephesians, as they began to realize that they were a chosen people. And we need to get in touch with the fact that we are a chosen people, because it is a life-changing revelation. It will change how you live, how you think, what we do as a church, how we decide to go forward. It all starts with the fact of what God has done for us, that he chose us for his purposes, for his good works, for his will, and for his pleasure. So we're going to look at that. Now, we could probably spend, I don't know how many weeks, just on this alone. This is the theology lesson all by itself. Some of you are familiar with Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. He was a Bible commentator, wrote a commentary on Ephesians alone that is literally about this long. So with some degree of apology and trepidation, to say that we're just going to do Ephesians for about 4 weeks it's almost malpractice. But we're going to hope and trust that God, as we touch down on certain themes, is really going to use this to encourage us and to transform not only our lives as individuals, but us as a church. So we're going to have to be somewhat selective of the verses that we're looking at. So let's look first at verse 4. What does verse 4 say? It says, "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." God is doing the choosing. He's choosing us for what purpose? To be holy and blameless in his sight. That's another way of saying he chose us for salvation. That's another way of saying he chose us so that we would live forever. Because both those things, salvation and eternal life, are firmly in the hands of Jesus. And they come through his work for us that made us holy and blameless. Why is that? Is God holy? Absolutely. Pure. No sin whatsoever. Not only is not even part of his character or his nature, it cannot even be a part of his presence. All those that are in the presence of God have to be holy. And all those who are in the presence of God have to be blameless. That is, without sin. So we understand that about God and we say, I agree, that makes sense. But then we look at ourselves and we say, are we holy? Answer, no. Are we blameless? No, we're not blameless. Because we're not holy, because we've been corrupted, because we're part of the fall, we do things that offend God and hurt other people, as well as hurting ourselves. And what Paul is saying here is that because of the work of Christ, we are now holy and blameless. God doesn't see our imperfections. God doesn't see the things that we've done wrong. God sees only Jesus and his blood covering us. And so that's a doxology all by itself. That's a praise all by itself. That should be mind-blowing all by itself. But if for some reason that is not enough, let's look at the first part of that phrase. It's in verse 4. For he chose us in him, that is in Jesus, when? Before the creation of the world. So you may have become a Christian relatively recently, last month, 3 years ago, 10 years ago. You date that as the time you started your relationship with Christ. When does he date your relationship with him? way before he made anything that we call creation, anything that we know as time, anything that we designate as history, any event that we can perceive or think or know, God said way before that, I purposed each one of you who knows my name to be in me, to have eternal life and life forever. Right. Mind-blowing. I mean, really, God, before you made anything, you already knew that I would have given my life last week to you? That my parents gave their life to you? I worked hard. I labored long in prayer. I talked to them. They shut me down. But Lord, you knew that they would come to faith even before you made any one of us? Yeah, that's what he's talking about. Man, do you get a sense of how much God loves us, how much worth and value he's given to us just by what Jesus has done and by the fact that he's done it way before we ever knew anything, ever saw anything? If that isn't enough, look at verse 5. In love he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with the pleasure of his will. We've been adopted to be his children, to be his sons or his daughters. You know, adoption in Bible times, they were in a predominantly Roman culture. And adoption then was very much the same as it is now. It was a formal, legal, public recognition bounded by law that said, this person who is not my blood relation is now part of my family with all rights and privileges therein. They fully belong to me. They have everything. All the blessings that I can give them now belong to them. The privileges that I have enjoyed now pass to them. It was actually something that aristocratic families in Rome, when they did not have an heir or somebody they thought was worthy of an heir, it wasn't unheard of for them to take a slave in their household and adopt that slave and say, this is now my son. And the idea behind that is this was a person who was going to be worthy to carry on the family name and to bring honor and glory to the family. And it was a legal, formal, public declaration and agreement. This is what Paul has in mind when he's writing to the Ephesians, because they would get that. They would know that in their culture. And he says, you've been adopted to sonship, to being a child of God. Well, okay, let's just quick review. We've been predestined before God made anything to be, holy and blameless, to have eternal life, to live forever. We've been now predestined to be adopted as his sons. Are you getting a sense at this point, hopefully, how much God truly values each one of us? How worthy he sees us, not because of something we have done, not because we're super cute or really bright or industrious. He already knew he'd put those things into us, but because of who he is. And he says the value and the worth that you have comes from me because I planned you and I made you. So it doesn't matter what the circumstances of how you got to this planet. You know, some people were saying, your folks weren't married or you were unplanned. Well, let me just tell you, these verses don't talk about anything being unplanned, do they? So I don't care what anybody said about how you got here or why you were here or this happened or that happened. Everybody's planned by God. And God's heart and his desire is to have everyone know that fully, to know the worth that you've been given by him, to know the value that you have. When we're in touch with that, when we're in touch with what God has done, it is transforming. Because there's all kinds of people that have been running us down or trying to take away the value that God has given us. You'll never amount to this. You can't do that. You're just like your so-and-so uncle over here who was never amounted to anything. I don't know what the messages are that you've been hearing, but often they start early on in our lives. And eventually we begin to believe them and we start to internalize them and we start to think, you know what, I'm not worthwhile. You know what? I don't have value. And we start to live out of that place of being beat down, of being feeling valueless. And then in the way that sin works, we start to contribute to our own beating down. We start to act out. We start to do the things that are in keeping with a lot of the negative and frankly wrong messages that people have been giving us. And so if that's you and you know what the contexts are for you, that's you. You know, this is just a hallelujah occasion to hear what God is saying and to say, I have given you more worth, more value than anybody can possibly take away. And so the word I hope for some of us here this morning is to get in touch with what God has done through his son, so that if you have any doubt about how precious you are to him, you say, wow, before I was ever made, you'd plan me. Before I was ever made, you knew that I would be a part of you, that I would, you wanted to be with me forever. You gave me that privilege. So you, that gives us courage to stand up, not in some sort of like, oh no. Well, maybe some people do need to hear, oh no, you don't. But most of it should be that attitude that I'm not going to receive those kinds of messages because they're just not true. Ephesians 1 says they are just not true. And we're just only on Ephesians 1. We could go through all of Scripture and point out just how valuable God's creation, we who are made in his image, are. So don't let people run you down with their negative things, the places they're speaking typically out of their own brokenness. Know that God has given you worth, he's given you value, and he's given us a purpose. Look at verse 12. Let's look at 11 and 12. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we might be for his praise, for the praise of his glory. Let me kind of shorten that. In him we were also chosen that we might be for the praise of his glory. The mere fact that God created us and that he sent Jesus to save us speaks to our value and worth. The fact that he created us to be for the praise of his glory speaks to the purpose he has for our lives. Value and purpose. Those are the things that are rooted and founded in Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. And this is what Paul is trying to convey to the Ephesians church. And so he kind of gets to the punchline in 11 and 12. He says, you were chosen. You're chosen what? To glorify God. To make him proud. 1 Peter says, you know, not only have we been chosen as individuals, but we've been chosen as a church. 1 Peter 2, verse 9, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. There's both in that one verse the sense that we are chosen and the purpose that he has given us, that we would proclaim the excellencies, proclaim the good things, talk about how all that stuff that God did for us. If you were somebody who got adopted, you were in a family or some kind of enslaved position, and God said, I'm now adopting you and making you my family, you're like, woohoo, I am no longer a slave. I belong to Maximus, you know, or whatever, if you like that, whatever that film, a gladiator. You know, I'm part of a good family. Now I'm part of some family that's really going to take ground for the kingdom. That's when we have that and we live out of that, we're going to start to glorify God. We're going to start to tell other people about all the good things, the excellencies that he's done in our life. You want to be an effective witness for Jesus? Here's the simple formula. Do stuff for him, follow him, and then tell others about what he's doing in your life. That's actually pretty straightforward. And so we want to be people that are glorifying God. We want to be people that are his image bearers. We've been chosen to reflect Christ. Jesus is here with his spirit. We praise God, but his earthly ministry, his public ministry was 3 years long. And after that, after he died on our behalf, was raised, and is now at the right hand of the Father, who is doing the work on earth? We are. Anybody else? You know, can I look behind me and like, I'm going to send Elder Carlton after him, you know, because I don't, you know. We don't realize how often God says, I've chosen you for that. This is your situation to glorify me in. Sometimes we don't necessarily like the assignments we've been given. We'd like to be a great recording worship artist, or we'd like to do something that has a certain amount of prestige to it. But God says, no, you know what? Your assignment to glorify me is over here. To be the caregiver for somebody that really needs care. To be that patient, long-suffering teacher in a classroom where you're not sure, or you're pretty convinced half the kids don't even care to be there. But there's a few kids that God's already has his hand on. There's a few kids that he's going to raise up out of that. There's a few kids that you are that place of hope in a chaotic home life. No calling is insignificant if it comes from God. No calling is going to be without fruit. No calling is going to be something that you can look and say to somebody else, oh, I wanted theirs. No, you've been designed very specifically for this time and the calling that you have. And if there's, you think that season's coming to an end, you can say, Lord, change my mind about what I'm going through or change my circumstances. Those are legit prayers. But while you're in there, know that you're able to glorify God by what you're doing and how you're doing it. And he's going to be proud of you. He's going to say, look at my sons, look at my daughters. He's going to be like, you know, you go to people's homes, maybe your own home, you see that they got pictures of their kids. And the kids are in a sports uniform, they're in a basketball uniform, or maybe they're in their military uniform, or maybe they've got a graduation cap and gown. These are milestones in the life of a person that you put up on your mantelpiece. You put up on your wall. Say, I'm proud. You ever go to somebody's house, do you see a picture of their kids texting or just like hanging out in a video game? No. I mean, kids do a lot of that, but that's not necessarily something that we're going to stand up as parents and go, yeah, that's what I want. Yeah, text away. Look. You know, so we don't really do that. We want to make sure, and we're trying to raise the young people in our life, if you're grandparents, parents, you're an auntie or you're an uncle, we want to raise those young people to fulfill the plan that God has for them. And so we call out those milestones. We put them up on our wall. That's what God does when we're faithful to him. He calls those out. And when we're doing that, I want us to know that we're being very much like Jesus. When Jesus came here, did he say, I'm just working my own agenda? No. He said, I'm only here to do what the Father showed me to do. And he did that so well and so perfectly that at the end of his ministry, he could say to Philip, have you been with me so long that you haven't recognized the Father yet? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So what it means to bring glory to God is to walk so closely with Jesus Christ that our friends, our family, our colleagues will be able to say, they may not say, I see Jesus, but sometimes you hear that. I have heard that. I've been privileged to hear that, where people come up, not me personally yet, but people say, man, I'm just working on my job, and somebody came up and said, there's something different about you. I just, when I see you in action, I just think of Jesus. I'm like, wow, that's great. What kind of performance review would you want that's better than that? That's ultimately what pleases our Lord and Savior, to be like him, to be his image bearer. Romans 8:29, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, just as his son was conformed to the image of his father, that we might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Again, the themes of adoption and living out for the Lord. So we're chosen to be image bearers. We're chosen to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. We're his workmanship. So God has a purpose for us. He's given us worth and given us value. He's given us a purpose to bring him glory by the things he's assigned for us to do. And so you're thinking, okay, I like that. But if I'm really honest with myself, there's challenges, issues, problems, concerns, doubts, fears, things that I'm experiencing, things that I'm feeling that frankly undermine my effectiveness. We read 1 Peter 2:9. Two verses later, Peter's in touch with that to the community he's writing to. And so he says, beloved, I urge you who are aliens and strangers in this world to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may actually, because of your good deeds, as they see them, glorify God in the day of visitation. In other words, he's saying, hey, you've been a chosen race. You are a chosen race. You're a royal priesthood. But watch out, because we know we're still in enemy territory. Watch out, because we're not perfected this side of heaven. Watch out, because we have an enemy who seeks to devour us. He prowls around like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so you're thinking, well, what do I do with that? What is the secret of actually living this life of worth and value that God has given me, of actually doing the good things that he's assigned me to do so that he will have glory brought to him? What's that secret? And the short answer, the secret to living as a chosen people, the secret of feeling, knowing that we belong to Christ because we've been adopted, the secret is to do all these things in Christ. In Jesus. You cannot live the life that we've just been talking about without being in Christ. And as if to underscore that point, in this one sentence doxology that Paul has been given us, he talks about all the blessings and that we've been looking at, and they are all in Christ. Let me just review out of that verses 3 through 14. We have every spiritual blessing in Christ. He chose us in him. We are predestined for adoption through Christ. He has given us his glorious grace in Christ. We have redemption through his blood in Christ. We have the forgiveness of sins in Christ. He has revealed the mystery of the knowledge of his will in Christ. He has brought unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were chosen to be for the praise of his glory, and you were included in Christ. There's no other way to live this life that God has given us except to be in Christ. So here's the question. If you're not in Christ, what are you in? Or what are you into that somehow is going to give you the value that only God can give you the purpose that only he brings? What are you into that you think is going to be better than than Christ? Now, the reality is we can be into a lot of different things. Some of us are not in Christ, we're in anger. Somebody did something to us a long time ago, and we've just been nursing it. Man, that hurts. Man, if only they knew. Man, I can't wait for payback. I'm just going to, you know, the Old Testament, they curse people. Is that okay, God? Can I curse? No, you cannot. You bless them. But people nurse grudges. People harbor resentment, and that is not a static thing. It is a root. It is called a root. It is called a root of bitterness, and that image is called a root because it says it grows. Roots don't just stay static. They're there to produce fruit. And if you haven't dealt with anger, if there's some person, some issue, something out there that every time you think of it, it continues to just darken your soul, you're in anger. And when you won't make amends, when you won't say, Lord, heal me from this or help me to deal with this, when you accommodate it, when in essence you're feeding that, you're watering it, you're in anger. You're in bitterness. You're not in Christ. We looked at Peter and he's talking about lust. He said some of it, you know, watch out for the lust of the flesh. He's giving him good advice. Some of us are dealing with lustful issues, and that's the whole range of things that are out there. From electronic to active to everything else. Next week is the Super Bowl. I mean, you got to even watch, I mean, you have to watch out for the commercials that are as much a part of that game. In fact, for some of us, they're actually more interesting than the game, but you have to watch out for that. Commercials now are saturated with the hypersexualized culture that we live in. Stuff that we would have considered PG, even R, 20 years ago, is now used to sell whatever. Now, that's not of God. It's just of the enemy to fuel those lusts, to keep us thinking that what? It's normal. It's abnormal from God's kingdom. It doesn't belong to us. It's something that we just need to guard ourselves from. Watch out for those kinds of things. And some of us can be trapped in those things. Some of us can be addicted to certain forms, certain patterns. If you're into lustful addictions, then you're not in Christ. It's not that, look, I'm very much in touch with those that are struggling. Nobody, you know, I'm sure I'm not really talking to people that are just folding their arms and going, yeah, that's me. You know, that's just the way I am. I can't change. But there is a great anxiety, a tension, a desire to be other. And we'll get to that in a little bit. But just know that when we accommodate certain things, when we accommodate things, when we try to live a life that's not in Christ, but is into something else, then we're not going to live the life that Christ has for us. We're not going to live out the purpose that he has for us as people or as a church. So it's important. Some of us are just into being, we're not into Christ, we're being into, you know, an old-fashioned word, slothful. To being lazy, to being just like, I'm just kicking it. I'm just amusing myself. And believe me, there's nothing wrong with kicking it. God rested on the seventh day. The question is how much you're just sort of chilling and maxing and relaxing and just going from here to there, not really doing much of this, and maybe I'll do something into that. Look, God's got far more interesting things for your life to be spent on than just going from here to there and doing this and doing that and being amused. Man, if you could see, if each one of us could see what God has in store for us as people, as individuals, us as a church, if we would say, Lord, here I am. You died for me. You are a ransom for my life. I can only give you my life back in return. Don't let me waste another moment. Don't let me get behind. I don't mean to create an anxiety. I just mean to create a purpose and a focus. Jesus didn't just, you know, he always knew where God was leading him, but he was never in a hurry. So this is not attended by anxiety, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? But it's attended by prayer. Just like, Lord, show me, help me be purposeful, help me be intentional. So I don't know, you know, what if you're not in Christ, are you in anger, are you in lust, are you just in sloth, indolence, and those kinds of things? You can be in Christ because that's where he wants you to be. And even if you know that you're in Christ, don't take that for granted. You know, this side of heaven, we still got an enemy who's coming at us. This side of heaven, we still need to be on the lookout, still need to be on our guard, still need to be watchful, being aware. When I was thinking about this and praying, like, Lord, what can I share with our community, with our body? What do you want me to hear personally? So that none of us are resting on our laurels or just saying, wow, Lord, thank goodness, I'm not like those other guys. You know, where have we heard that before? Well, that was the Pharisee who was praying. He's like, I'm not as bad as some people. Okay, that may be true, but watch out. This is why Peter is writing. And when I prayed that prayer, God gave me, you know, the story of Achan in Joshua 6 and Joshua 7. Some of you know that. This is the story where Joshua is about, with his army of Israelites, is about to defeat Jericho. Victory has already been forecast. Jericho was a pagan nation or pagan place, and they had formidable walls. And if you remember that story, you know that God's plan was unlike any other military plan. There was no siege works, no big attack, no long duration. He just said, march around for 6 days, the walls of Jericho. And then on the seventh day, you march around 7 times, you blow the horn, and you shout. And at that moment, the walls will come down, and you guys rush in. Victory is assured. And Joshua, the text that we're looking at, Joshua 6, 18, is given final instructions. Like all the guys are huddled up, ready to charge. And he says, okay, as soon as the walls come down, here's what I want you to do. Some of you guys go get Rahab. She was the prostitute who saved the spies. And you make sure that she and her family are safely out of that wall, out of Jericho. Because everybody else it's not going to go well for them. And then the other thing I want you to do is make sure nobody takes the devoted things with the riches and the treasure, the gold and the silver and the riches of Jericho. No Israelite takes those. They're supposed to go to the treasury of God. Everybody got it? Got it. So the walls come down, they rush in, they get Rahab out, and they almost obey. They almost obey except Achan. And Achan takes some of the devoted things. And Joshua doesn't know it. He doesn't know it until he goes to attack another city called Ai. Ai is this little outpost, not much of anything. You know, Joshua didn't even send a full army, just like a battalion of guys to go take it. It should be a layup, but it's not. It's an absolute clanger. They get defeated by this pitiful little group at Ai. They're absolutely beat down. They have to run away. And Joshua, as a leader, is like, where did I miss it? He's crying out to God. And God says, literally, stand up, stop whining. Here's what happened. Somebody disobeyed. Somebody did what they weren't supposed to do. Joshua 7, verses 10 and 11, the Lord said to Joshua, stand up. Why are you down on your face? Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They've taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen. They have lied. They've put them with their own possessions. That is why Israel cannot stand against their enemies. When we're not living in Christ, but in something else, we're just like Achan, who took the devoted things. We're looking for something that these would give us that only God can give us. Maybe we're looking for it in some relationship sometimes. This is why we get, you know, LinkedIn to, you know, not that LinkedIn, but you know, connected with relationships that aren't good for us, because we think that that person, even though they haven't chosen us, in fact, the opposite, we're chasing somebody, and we think that they can give us only what God has designed to give us. And so we do all kinds of things to sort of, you know, pump that up. But don't pump it up. Go to God and say, is that a relationship you want me to have? And if he says no, you got to treat that like the devoted things, get rid of it, then get rid of it. So we have to go, but some of us don't see the power of God in our lives today because we're hanging on to stuff. Achan took the treasure. He took it to his tent and he buried it. He didn't think anybody would know, anybody would care. You know, maybe he rationalized. That's another thing we do. We rationalize our disobedience to God. Achan probably said, look, I just took a few things. What's the deal? And nobody's going to miss it. I mean, most of the stuff that we got from Jericho already went to the treasury. Okay, 95% complete. I just took 5%. But he clearly violated what God was very explicit about. And so if you're rationalizing why it's okay to be into something other than Christ, you got to learn from Achan. What happened? So Israel didn't have power. They got, you know, they got destroyed, but not destroyed. They got beaten by Ai. When we harbor things, when we compromise, when we disobey what God says, you know what? It's not us who are immediately impacted as much as it's people around us. The first victims of Achan's sin were Israelites that tried to take Ai. Oftentimes, the first victims of the things that we're doing wrong are those that are closest to us. They're people in our family. They're people that we care about. They're people on our job site. Those are the ones who usually or oftentimes will feel the first effects of our disobedience. But eventually, we will feel that impact. So if you know the story, you know that God tells Joshua, he said, you basically got to root out the sin, call the tribes one by one, and we're going to see who's done what. And so they call, Achan was a part of the tribe of Judah, and they call Judah and they call his grandfather's group, the Zerahites. They come, there's nobody there. And so then they winnow it down to his grandfather, who is Zimri, and then they go to his dad, finally, who is Carmi. And eventually they get to Achan. And there's no hiding at that point. Achan's sin, he confesses. What can he say? The Lord has called him out. And so Achan replied, it's true, I've sinned against the Lord and the God of Israel. This is what I did. When I saw the plunder, in the plunder, a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver, a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them, I took them, and I took them to my tent, and I buried them. What's buried in your tent? Is there something that you know that isn't of God that you're hanging on to? Here's a hint about how that might be. You haven't told anybody about it, but it occupies your mind. You think about it, or that person. And you know if you told somebody about it who claimed the name of Jesus, they'd be like, I love you too much to let this go. We got to talk. We got to do some stuff. Is there something that you're hanging on to? It could be in any of those categories we were talking about. It could be bitterness. Could be lust. Could be slothfulness. Could be a number of things. But you haven't told anybody. Achan's sin resulted in Achan's death. Achan's sin resulted in the death of many other Israelites who didn't have the power of God to do what they thought God was clearly calling them to do. When we harbor those things, the people we care about are going to suffer. That's just the way it is. So Achan was taken out, he and his family, and they were stoned to death. Because God wouldn't have that imperfection in Israel. But aren't you glad that we don't live in those times? Aren't you glad that the very Savior, Jesus Christ, who came down, says, I know you've got something buried, but I want to help you unbury it. I don't want you to be killed by it. I don't want the loved ones that you have to be harmed by it. He comes alongside of us. And he says,
Let's go to the tent. Let's go look at that. Let's go pull that carpet back. Let's go raise that stuff out. I'm here with you. You don't have to do this alone. You are not alone. When you've got stuff that's buried, when you think that this is your way of salvation, when you think that this is the only possible thing that's bringing you life or bringing you some kind of joy in this world, God says no. He says, be like an Ephesian. Turn your mind to what God has done for you. Unbury the putrid junk that you think has given you life, the stuff that is only going to be, it's just not going to do anything but bring you destruction. And he says, but you don't have to do it alone. Would you take my hand? Would you say, Lord, I can't do this by myself. Would you come with me, please? If you say that, he will do that. How will he do that? Maybe he'll send somebody to you. Is Jesus here physically on earth? We asked that question earlier. No, he's not. Are you on earth? Yes. Are you willing to be asked by somebody who's got stuff buried in their tent? Would you help me? I'm just so ashamed. When we bury things, it's because we're so ashamed. That's the enemy's tool, shame and secrecy and darkness. But we're children of the light. We should be equipped to be alongside our brothers and sisters who are faced with that. And just if somebody comes at you and says, look, I want to tell you what's going on in my life, you can't be grimed out. You don't be like, oh my goodness. You say, by God's grace, let me help you. And there are resources in this church, and there are people that you know that can help. Jesus would do that because he says, you know what? You belong to me. We are chosen to belong. We are chosen to live out the God-given worth that he has brought us. We are chosen to live out the purpose that exceeds anything we can possibly think or imagine, not only as people, but as a church. We are chosen to do that. Don't go after devoted things. Don't go after treasure that is never going to do anything but harm you and hurt those that you care about. Know that you belong to the family of God, that you can stand up and say, Lord, I belong to you. By your help, let's go and bury some stuff. Let's unpack it, Lord. Help me out. Now, final exhortation. If you don't have stuff that's really buried, I mean, it's like you got it unburied and you got a whole team of people working on it. You got the whole archaeological dig and they've excavated it. That's great. You know what God is doing for you, through you in that way? He's really equipping you to be alongside of other people. And as God, in my hope and my prayer, when you think of the culture that we're in, you think of the strategic time, the strategic place that we're in as a church, we're in Silicon Valley, one of the most amazing places that you can possibly be. You know, in one sense, you don't have to be an international missionary. There's so many international people here. If we would just be who God has created us to be, we'd have a worldwide impact. And in its essence, what that is to show people the love of God, to show people to whom they truly belong, that they can have life forever and have a purpose that'll blow their mind. We do that. We show that we live like we belong to the family of God. We will see more and more people say, tell me what you got because I want it. Amen? Amen. Would you stand with me, please?